So, hello again. As you know, I'm Eli, the computer guy, and we are doing yet another Coffee with Geeks. We are here with Cahlan Sharp, CEO and founder of DevMountain. So a lot of folks are asking about boot camps. So I figured bring on an actual CEO and founder of a coding boot camp and talk to him about what it's actually like and what you should be thinking about if you're interested in going to a boot camp. So thanks for being here, Cahlan.
Hey, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Yeah. So give us an idea of like what exactly is a boot camp? So when people start talking about boot camps, what does that actually mean?
Yeah, typically boot camps, they're talking about a condensed accelerated program. They're usually 12 weeks where you go and learn a skill. Typically, it's been coding up until this point. Mm. But you basically spend 12 really intense weeks, you know, every day, just really intense accelerated process to learn code and to get job ready.
Okay. So like how many hours, like when you talk about boot, because I used to go to, you know, back to MCSE boot camps, which I guess are lame compared to these ones where we go for like 4 hours, you know, two or three times a week. Like,
right.
Like when you say boot camp or coding boot camp, how many hours a day, days a week are we talking about?
Well, I mean, for our particular, you know, at DevMountain, we require students to be there from 9 to 5, you know, 5 days a week. Mm. But any of the students that are going to be successful are usually there well past, either before or past the kind of the allotted hours. It's like a lot of things. It's all about the time and the effort you put in. In our case, it's a lot about the kind of the condensing of all that time. So you're actually learning at a faster rate than if you were to spread that out over a longer period of time. But yeah, it's a lot of hours. I mean, these guys are working 60, 70, 80 hour weeks in many cases to make sure they're up to speed on the content they're trying to get through.
So, I mean, one of my questions with all this, though, because I've been through a lot of tech training. And the thing is, I mean, at a certain point, I don't know, maybe I'm stupid, but, you know, at a certain point in the day, my brain stops. Like, that's one thing I don't understand with the book. Like how does your brain keep working 12 hours of this stuff?
Well, I guess there's different ways to look at it. The metaphor that I usually use is your brain can handle a lot more than you think it can. I guess that's number one that I would start out with is a lot of people don't think they can learn this stuff as quickly as they actually can. And it's kind of like physical exercise, you know, you get a personal trainer and suddenly you're doing things that you never thought you could do because they're pushing you, right? They're pushing you past your limits. It's a similar type of environment here where we know what students are capable of even before a lot of times they know. Hmm. And so we're kind of pushing them past that point of like, you just stick with it. The other thing is it's not like they're just sitting there, you know, reading books all day. The schedule of a typical day is they come in the morning, they do some review. They spend some time on kind of a practice problem that's kind of a brain teaser, or, you know, get their brains going for the day. They'll sit through, you know, like a lecture type format where they're kind of listening and cooperating and, you know, participating in a discussion. And then there's a series of projects through the rest of the day. So it's not just kind of the learning and studying and listening and then reading. A lot of it is hands-on, a lot of it is project work. And I think when you break it up like that, you know, it's a little easier for your, you know, for you to keep up with that instead of just it all being one activity, like sitting through class for 6 hours straight, right? Like that would be terrible. it's still tough though. I mean, a lot of people, they require maybe some caffeine or something, or whatever it takes for them to stick with it. But that's the way they work. The metaphor I use is you kind of, we want to get your brain in this like soup. Like we want to get it just to the point where it's like curing, like it's simmering well enough that we can really get you going. Once you're to the point where you're kind of in the rhythm and you're able to keep up with the content, that it's amazing what people can accomplish in the short time they have.
Yeah, that's it. So does it go 7 days a week or just then 5 days a week?
There's scheduled activities for 5 days a week, but again, a lot of the students are working on things or keeping up or reviewing stuff over the weekend as well.
Oh, I see. So somebody coming to one of these programs, do they have to have prerequisites? Should they have prerequisites? Like, do you just walk in the door, like any moron walks in the door and you can train them up? Like, what's your thought there?
So one of the biggest challenges with running a solution like this is that the variance of the ability of your students in the class can be a real hindrance to getting everybody where they need to be, right? So if you show up on the first day and there's 20 people and five of them are super advanced, 10 of them are kind of middle of the road and five of them probably shouldn't be there, then that basically sets the tone for your entire class where the lowest common denominator, you can never move fast, you can never move slow enough for those guys, right? So the prerequisite, the we call it pre-coursework, is really, really important because we need to level set that playing field as much as possible and make sure that everybody's at the same baseline. That's one of the ways that we can move so fast, right? Because if you've ever been in a class where there's, you know, maybe you're getting it or maybe you're the person that's not getting it, it kind of holds up everybody, right? Because everybody's waiting for their questions to be answered and for them, you know, explaining everything again. And so the speed is so important here that we want to make sure everybody's at that same basic level.
So will you kick people out will you refuse their check if they're not up to that level?
Yeah. And in fact, each program is a little bit different. We offer different programs. One is in design, one is iOS coding, so app development, and the other one is in web development. Right. And they kind of each handle it a little bit differently. But for example, in the web development program, if you show up on day one, we give you an assessment that basically sees how well you understand the pre-course material that you did. And if you score really poorly on that, we may ask you to defer, to come back and do another start date, because you just won't succeed. You're going to fall behind from the very first day and you just will never catch up. So we've gotten pretty good at figuring out who is ready and who needs more time.
Okay. So then what are the types of people that you see like going to this boot camp? Are they 20-year-olds, 50-year-olds? Like, is there anything like surprising?
You know, I've seen people from all different walks of life. I'd say our typical student, you just kind of average student, is mid-20s, more males than females. And that kind of speaks to the challenge that we have of trying to get more women in coding and in engineering. It's a much bigger problem, much bigger scope than what we're talking about now. But they a lot of them have some sort of traditional university experience. Some of them have been to college, some of them finished college, some of them dropped out. Many times they've either started down a career path or, you know, they're kind of a certain ways down and they just decide it's not for them. For example, we've had a good number of like finance or accounting people that went to school for however long and got their master's of accounting and then decided this is terrible, I don't want to do this anymore. So I would say there's a good portion of the people that I would consider kind of career switchers, right? They're people that are trying to do a pivot in their professional life. Maybe they're unhappy, maybe the earning potential isn't good enough, whatever. And they see this as a good avenue to kind of, you know, kickstart the next chapter of their lives. There's another good percentage of the people that haven't really had a lot of career experience, but they know this is where they want to be, and they just want to find the fastest route from A to B that they can get. And so, and then there's a scattering of other kinds of people in there. There might be some entrepreneurs in there that are really interested in being more hands-on in their startup and building, you know, actually building some of their product rather than outsourcing everything. You would get some older people. We can't take people too young, just for pure kind of regulatory and insurance purposes and whatnot. But they run the gambit.
That's interesting because I have a lot of younger folks watching. What is the youngest that you can take? I didn't even think about that.
Well, they've got to be, depending on the state, they've got to be at least 18 years old. And, there's just, whenever you get minors and adults in the same room, there's all kinds of insurance stuff that you got to consider and regulatory things. I guess just kind of to speak to that for a moment, it is interesting to us that, like, you'll see a lot of programs, whether colleges or, you know, training programs, vocational schools, whatever, market to high school seniors, right? Yeah. We don't typically go after that demographic, not because we don't think they're valuable people, but a lot of times they don't necessarily know what they want yet in life.
Yeah.
And this isn't really a place to kind of explore what you might want. Like, this is the kind of place where you know what you want and you want to get there as quickly as possible. So I think that's why the age demographic skews a little bit higher, because these are typically people that really want to get in there. But we have seen some of the younger folks that are just super focused and know exactly what they want to do. They feel like it's their life calling. They've been tinkering with programming since they were little, and they just want the fastest avenue to get into the career, and they do just fine if they've got that motivation.
Yeah. So do you deal with, because that's one thing I don't understand with all the boot camps. I've been this while, and I know with the IT boot camps, is we had a huge amount of burnout. Like when I went through my MCSE boot camp, we had 26 people in there. And I honestly think it was me and one other guy who actually got our MCSEs.
Wow.
And you what I don't understand is you never hear about coding bootcamp burnout. And like, do you have any of that issue? Do you lose people during the classes that they just realize, what the hell did I get myself into?
No matter what, you're always going to lose somebody. I mean, there are some people that just have really crappy life situations that happen to them in class, like, oh, my dad passed away, or I'm getting a divorce, or whatever. Man. So there's that kind of stuff that happens. And then, yeah, there's people that just, when they really, really get into it, decide, you know what, this isn't really what I wanted after all. We definitely don't have as high of a burnout as what you're referring to. And part of that is just, as a business model, like, we want to make sure we have as many people that are ready as possible in that class. Otherwise, we waste a lot of time and money in getting people into classes and getting enrollment. So, we try to minimize that as much as possible. I mean, part of it is we really want to see people be successful, and we're invested in their success. Our student success comes back to our success, because as they're getting jobs, that looks really good for us. And so we want them to be as prepared and as ready as possible. So we do a lot to kind of pre-screen and really ask some of those tough questions and have them do the pre-coursework to make sure they're ready.
Okay. And then do you allow, like when I went through the IT boot camp, so you could recycle. So if you got to the end of the MCSE program, had no idea what was going on, you could literally hop into the next course cycle and go through it. I don't really hear that with coding boot camps. Do you allow that at all? Or?
Yeah, that's something that we do. I agree with you. It's not something that's typical for coding boot camps, but that's just something, I guess, for us and what we value, that's important for us. Again, going back to the whole kind of, we're invested in student success, right? If we've got a student that is on week four and they're just really struggling, we'd rather give them the option to, you know, jump into the next class that's going to start and see if they can pick it up at that point. Sometimes a week or two can make all the difference in helping them to get up to speed. We don't want somebody to pass or fail just based on needing a few extra days to really master the content.
Yeah, okay, makes sense. And then see your classes. So you have web development, iOS, and UX design. Those are your three main courses. Uh-oh. Oh, he dropped off. Come back to me, Cahlan. Oh, are you there?
Yeah, Google just decided to sign me out of my account at that exact moment. So that was really convenient.
That was scary.
Sorry about that.
Talking about UX design, but anyways. Okay, so your classes are web, iOS, and UX design. So out of curiosity, and that's one curious thing, like whenever you see these coding boot camps, I don't see like a lot of Java or like C#. Like how did you decide upon these three areas to go after?
Well, I think you got to look at what do coding boot camps excel at? And I would say one of the things they excel at is teaching super ultra modern, kind of like cutting edge technology, right? One of the problems that employers have with traditional education is like, yeah, you know, for universities, they can crank out CS grads that have a little bit of experience in, say, Java or C# or something like that, or C++, but that may only be a small subset of what their tech stack actually is at their company. And then they have to take these CS grads in, they've got to teach them all the modern frameworks and languages that are actually being used on the job. And traditional education is just really poorly equipped to actually adapt to that curriculum and teach the modern stuff. And so I think for that reason alone, you know, coding boot camps are able to go very much to the edge and start with what is happening today and happening right now, and then work backwards from that into some of the theory. So, you know, that way when students get there on day one, they're able to actually contribute and, you know, produce and just, you know, anecdotally, I've had employers tell me like, look, your guys matched up just as well, if not better than some of the CS grads that we interviewed. And not that that's a one-to-one comparison, because, you know, a four-year experience at a school is a lot more than just what you learn about coding, but in terms of kind of the practical experience and the know-how to come in day one and start coding, sometimes we can show ourselves really well.
That makes sense. So then you decided on like iOS versus Android. Should we read something into that, or is that just happens to be the instructors you had at the time when you're developing the class?
I don't think there's anything super strategic about that. I think it was more, yeah, we had some really good relationships with people that were invested in having iOS be successful. We felt like there was a strong job market to be able to place those people here locally. And there was enough demand specifically for iOS development that we felt like we could get people in the class. So there's nothing that says that we can't offer Android in the future.
Okay, cool. And then you say UX design. So that's one that not everybody offers. What does that actually mean then, if somebody's interested in that?
So I think I kind of view UX design as kind of the modern approach to how you design stuff, right? I mean, we always think of designers as like people that are just in Photoshop or Illustrator all day making visual assets, right? Building up web pages or, you know, kind of Photoshop files that web developers go in and change. Yeah. And that's one aspect of design, right? Like you can obviously spend your time doing that. But I think modern day designers look at design a lot more holistically than they used to. It's not just making something look good, it's making it functional, and it's making it in a way that best appeals to your audience, right? Good yeah. product design, good user experience design is very holistic. It's not just what is being shown on the page. And so I think there's a ton of demand, employer demand for good UX designers, people that understand that holistic process, people that are willing to start talk to customers and go through kind of the feedback cycle, that iterative cycle that design should be. And so we try to teach, you know, the principles of design and some of those pragmatic, you know, tool-based stuff, but all in the context of this holistic experience.
That's interesting. So, I mean, I would have thought that UX design is an add-on, but is this something that you can you go directly into UX design and actually expect a job, or is this, you've done a computer science degree, now you want that UX design add-on type of deal?
Most of them aren't computer science folks, but yeah, we feel really strongly that we can take people that don't have a lot of experience, but that have an affinity or an aptitude for design and get them to the point where they're ready, you know, they're ready to go get an entry-level UX job. And we're just finishing up with our first cohort right now. So, you know, I guess the proof will be in the pudding in that sense, but our instructors are all really positive about where their students' abilities are at. They feel like they're very employable. And so we're hoping that'll be true.
That's cool. Well, then something like that. Do you work with employers to figure out what the curriculum is? Like, how do you decide what the curriculum for something like that is?
It's a bit of a balancing act, right? Because you want to make sure that you're providing something that employers need right now, today, without getting too specific to each employer, right? Because if you go and ask 10 employers what you should teach, they're each going to tell you something different and different stuff to focus on. So it's a little bit of a pragmatic approach to, like, you know, say, okay, these technologies are pretty much true across the board. And we can kind of generalize the principles there so that they're reaching as many employers as possible without getting so specific that, like, you know, we're only teaching one company's tech stack and nobody else really uses that. But, you know, responding to the market in that sense is really important to us. And I'll give you an example. We used to teach a certain database, in our web development class because it fit really well with our curriculum. And we just kept hearing students going out and saying, you know what, no employer is looking for that. They're looking for this other database instead. And so we switched our curriculum because it just didn't make sense for us to continue teaching students things that they wouldn't actually be using. And so we wanted to make them employable as possible.
Okay. Now, I guess that's one thing, like with changing your curriculum. I mean, I know a lot of education or training programs get bogged down in the red tape of whatever state or municipality they're in. Like, being a coding bootcamp, do you somehow size? Because I know, like, depending on what you're technically classified as, a lot of times you can sidestep that red tape. Are you able to do that, or do you actually have to get certified by the states you're in?
You know, I think that's one of our strengths is we're not accredited. So we don't necessarily have to report to any third party kind of what our curriculum is. And I mean, we are regulated by each state that we operate in. So there are definitely some checks and balances there in terms of, you know, we have to show that we're not just a bunch of fraudsters, right, trying to take people's money. Yeah. We have to show that there's actual stuff being taught and all that good stuff. But they don't have a lot of, they don't have a lot of granularity control into what we're teaching and how we're teaching it, which gives us a ton of flexibility and freedom to be able to teach what we feel like is going to be the most powerful and the most impactful and to be able to adapt very quickly. And just, you know, anecdotally, there's been a few times I've spoken to universities locally and they may want to incorporate some of the things we're teaching or kind of partner up on a class. And they always tell me typically it takes like a year to get a class from conception to actually offering it to students. And that, like, that's just crazy to me because in a year our curriculum will change pretty dramatically. And so by the time the class would actually get up and going, it would be out of date. Web development just, you know, these fields just change too quickly to be able to have curriculum that's static like that.
Oh, okay. And then so you're in your locations, you're in three locations. So Provo, Utah, right? Salt Lake City, correct. Dallas.
Yep, like, you got it.
Is there any rhyme or reason to that? Is there any rhyme or reason in the tech world, or does that just happen to be where you lived type of deal?
So I just moved back from San Francisco in 2013 when we started, and was living in Utah. And just, I mean, to be perfectly honest with you, just kind of stumbled upon this because I enjoy teaching. I love education and I love, you know, technology. I love coding. And so I just decided to start teaching part-time coding classes just on the side while I was working full-time. And it happened to be in Utah, and it happened to catch on, and there was just a ton of demand for it. And it kind of just became this thing that I had never planned on it becoming. And so, you know, Utah is an interesting place. I feel really fortunate that we started in Utah because Utah is one of these kind of tech centers that is not a Silicon Valley. It's not really recognized as like, oh, this mecca of technology, but yet there's so much demand for developers here. There's such a strong kind of tech backbone running up and down the, called the Wasatch Front. And there's people, you know, there's kind of the two sides of it. There's employers that are asking for developers, and then there are people that really want to get into tech. And so that combination makes it so that we can offer what we offer. Now the Dallas expansion, it kind of speaks to a little bit of our business model and who we are. So, you know, if you compare us to other boot camps, you know, not taking anything away from them, but we just service kind of a different demographic of people in the sense that, you know, not everybody can afford to pay 20 grand and move to a market like San Francisco or New York City to take a boot camp. I mean, that's expensive stuff, especially when you start considering housing and where you're going to live and taking off time from work and everything else. And so we made a decision early on that, hey, like, we operate in a place where the cost of living is remarkably low compared to larger markets. So let's do things like offer them free housing. Let's make sure the price point is affordable as we can possibly make it. That way, you know, that way people aren't having to decide, you know, like, we can just give them a better comparison and say, hey, come here and learn everything you need to learn, get a job without having to break the bank. And so Dallas is another market where we feel like we can still offer those same amenities and at the price point that we need to offer it at. Dallas is a huge metro area. Yeah. There's a lot of demand for developers, but yet the cost of living is remarkably affordable for most, you know, for the most part. So it works like that.
So about how much is the tuition then for one of these programs?
So for the full-time classes, it's typically $10,900, so just under $11,000.
But then, yeah, I guess that's one of the curious things, because one of the things I like about your program is you offer the housing, but then I guess that's 3 months of housing, because I think most boot camps charge at least $12,000, and that's, you know, without anything else in there. So how do you do that? Is it just the model?
It's part of the model. I mean, we have structured kind of our educational model to be, it's kind of an interesting blend of mentorship and instruction. You know, one of your highest costs when you run a boot camp is paying instructors. And we have a really unique way of approaching instruction in a way that is both effective and cheaper. Mm-hmm. And part of that involves using what we call mentors, which are students that completed the program, you know, in cohorts previous. And studies have actually shown that, you know, people that are closer to you in terms of ability level, but maybe just a step above, are actually a lot of times more able to teach you what you need to know faster than somebody who's like got a big gap and is way more expert. Because if you think about it, right, if you're an expert, you know, say you've been doing this for decades or something, you don't have a lot of empathy or understanding for somebody who's just starting out, right? You're like, come on, guys, why don't you get this? Whereas mentors who've just been through it, they understand exactly what it's like, and they know what kind of questions you have, and they know what kind of things you're going to struggle with. So we rely a lot on that model to both help push the education forward and keep the costs down, you know, because paying six-figure salaries for developers gets really expensive really quickly. And again, that the markets that we operate in, right? Like, there's no way we could do this in San Francisco at this price point, because the housing alone would just kill us. So, you know, it comes back to our business model.
And then that was the only thing I was looking at, because the only concerning part is I was looking at the housing, and it says, you know, free and all that. But then it's like this weird, like, first come, first serve. So what, like, when you say free housing, what does that actually mean?
So it basically, what we're trying to do is say that there may be a point where we run out of capacity, and that's happened not too often, but a few times where we've just got so many students in housing that we can't offer any more spots, right? Like, we just can't physically produce more rooms. And so we just kind of put that in there as a caveat to say, look, we most likely can give you free housing, but there may come a point where you may have to wait to, for another start date in order, you know, to get the housing piece. And then there's also the play with kind of the local people, right? Because we've got people locally that may be commuting 30 or 45 minutes that if we've got extra space, yeah, we'll offer them housing. But hey, if there's not a, you know, if it's between you and a guy from Chicago, like, you can commute, right? Like, we gotta try to be flexible for everybody. So,
okay. So that was my only concern. So this isn't going to be like a United incident where you show up for the housing and find out, no, you don't have housing. Get the hell out.
We are not going to forcibly remove any students from housing unless they're like breaking the law or something like that. And that would be the police, not us. So yeah, fortunately I don't have to. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense then. Okay. So the people go through the program, and then what can they expect after? Because again, one of the things that I get concerned about is it's all this cotton candy and fairy dust. You go through the boot camp, and then I don't even understand these like the employment rates. The math doesn't even make sense. Like 99% of our graduates are employed within 2 weeks or something. Like with you, like what is a reasonable expectation once you graduate your program?
Yeah, I actually just talked with another YouTuber about this the other day, and I, you know, we try to be really candid and upfront with students because honestly, a big part of it is setting correct expectations. We don't want students thinking that, you know, they're going to be handed a job on a silver platter for six figures the moment they walk out the door, yeah. And then that not happen, right? That's not good for us. So typically what we've seen with full-time programs is that right around 80% of our students are able to get jobs within 3 to 6 months of completing the program. Okay. And to me, what that represents is, you know, education is a two-way street. And, you know, it'd be great if we could force everybody to be exactly the right, you know, kind of student that we need. Some students are super prepared and they work really, really hard. Other students, we got to kind of hold their hands a little bit more and push them along. There's just always that give and take in education. But ultimately, you know, that means that if you are able to work hard, you know, put in a bunch of effort, and ultimately, I tell, you know, we tell students all the time, your first job coming out of this program is to get a job. Like, getting your first job can be a real grind sometimes, and sometimes it takes 15 no's to get your first yes. That's just the way it is. It's a grind for a lot of people. Sometimes, you know, the clouds part and the fairy dust falls down and you get a job offer at the hiring event. And sometimes it takes a couple months to get to that point. And I've seen super talented people take way longer than I expected to get a job. And I've seen people that I was like, get a job within the first couple of weeks. So sometimes it's about who you know. Sometimes it's about timing, luck, whatever. But yeah, I guess just to summarize, I would say, you should expect to be able to be employable when you come out of the class. We kind of commit to students that we won't finish you. We won't graduate you out of the program unless we feel like you're job ready. And so at that point, it's a lot, you know, we will try to introduce you to companies and give you leads and there's a hiring event and all that kind of stuff. But it's kind of up to you to polish your resume, to make sure you've got good interviewing skills, and get in there and impress those employers and get your first gig. Once you've got your first gig, I mean, the number one thing junior developers lack is experience. And once you've got that first gig, you've got some of that experience and it's just, you know, it's all downhill from there.
So, I mean, can they expect actual technical jobs? Because that's one thing, like, I was looking at this a couple of years ago when bootcamp started to get big and you start actually going through like the legalese of what they say with what people are getting hired. And you find out a lot of people are getting hired as secretaries at startups, but hey, that's employed, right? Like, are most of your people actually getting like technical jobs or?
Yeah, I don't think we'd be able to sleep at night if we were counting secretaries as part of our job placement numbers. Maybe other people can, I don't know. But the actually, just to play off of that, there's a new initiative starting of a coalition of boot camps that have gotten together and basically committed to a framework of reporting when it comes to outcomes. So what you'll start seeing is people reporting their outcomes data in a standardized way. And that is what this industry needs, right? Because it's just too easy to kind of have different definitions of what a job is and what full-time is and what placement means. And that just lends itself to ambiguity. And I mean, in the worst cases, it lends itself to borderline fraud, right? When you've got people that are claiming things that aren't true. But when you've got that kind of variability in interpretation, it just opens itself up to too much problems. And so you'll start seeing in the coming months a lot more transparency and standardization when it comes to reporting And it's going to be honestly very broken out to where it's not just how many people got a job in X amount of days. It's okay, based on all of your students, where did they end up? Well, this percentage ended up full-time in the field, you know, full-time paying jobs. This percentage got contract jobs. This percentage got part-time jobs. This percentage are working, you know, out of field. I mean, those are the secretaries or whatever. So you'll see everybody represented in those reports. And we kind of wholeheartedly support that because it's that kind of accountability is what this industry needs so that everybody's able to take it a bit more serious. And honestly, like, I know for a lot of people, they kind of raise an eyebrow and say, "What? Really? Can you?" And even some of our students come in and they're like, "Okay, I really hope you guys are being serious." Yeah. And I've seen it. I've seen it dozens and dozens and dozens of times where students are able to get jobs and they kind of, you know, they're just blown away. They're like, "I didn't realize that I could actually do this." And not to sound too sales pitchy or anything, but that's why I did this, right? Like I was very happy as a software developer coding and building products. But when I started to see what kind of impact this had on people's lives, I'm like, man, what better endeavor could I be involved in than building something that is both a strong business and changes people's lives? It's hard to beat that.
That makes sense. So do you plan to keep expanding? So if you've gone into Dallas, are you going to get up to 10 or 20 of these things, or what are you thinking?
We're going to continue kind of exploring the best ways to grow. I think we're at a really interesting spot, right? Like typically when you have a school of some sort, like they're just going to build a bigger campus, a bigger building, and they're going to have more people come in. Ours is an interesting model where we're kind of trying this, you know, different campus option. And there's a lot of challenges that come along with that. There's a lot of opportunity too. And so we look at this as a big experiment and we're going to continue poking and prodding and seeing what's successful and what's not. I think anytime you're a business where you feel like you've got something of value and you want to, you know, bring it to more people, then you're going to try to grow. So whether that's, more locations, whether it's fewer locations, but bigger locations, you know, time will tell.
So, I mean, do you think we're in any kind of a boot camp bubble at this point? Since it does, almost seems like accelerators were, not very common, you know, 6-7 years ago, and now you're tripping over them. It kind of feels like, it doesn't feel like boot camps are quite there, but it does seem like they're on that trajectory. Is that just my opinion?
I guess I would say that we're past the initial kind of euphoric wave of excitement. I would say that. I don't know if there is a bubble or if that bubble has started to burst or anything, but I think we've kind of passed that initial wave where everybody just had this fairy tale enchantment, including the press, with what boot camps were and what they could do. And we've since seen kind of the press go on the other side and say, well, are these boot camps really all they are cracked up to be? And we've even had a couple really bad actors in the space that have just taken people's money and done some really terrible things. And and anytime you've got a market like this that's exploding and there's kind of newcomers, there's always going to be good actors and bad actors. And part of this standards reporting thing I was telling you about earlier is a direct response to that, right? We want to make sure that we as an industry all look as good as we can, because if one bad player comes in and pisses off some regulators or takes people's money, then that's bad for everybody. Yeah. So, I think that people are a little bit more realistic and skeptical, and I think that's a good thing. I don't want people coming here that think they've got the wool pulled over their eyes. I want people to know exactly what they're getting into and know that it's going to be tough and you're going to have to work hard and you may have to take 6 to 8 weeks to get that first job, but like, you can do it. That's kind of our message to students, is if you work hard, stay positive, and just keep at it, you'll be just fine.
All right. And then, so the federal government's looking to get in, or maybe they've already gotten in with trying to help fund, you know, the boot camp thing. Does that make you excited or nervous? Like, where do you fall on that?
Yeah, I guess we'll wait and see, right? I think that, I'm not necessarily super politically motivated, but I'm not sure that always adding government is a good idea. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. Yeah. But I mean, for me, I get really worried when we start talking about things like taking federal money, because that's exactly, you know, in other spaces like the for-profit education sector, there's been some bad actors there that's the kind of incentive that can lead you to do things that that maybe you didn't intend to do starting out with, right? We don't want to be giving out free iPads to people just to sign up and get their federal money and then not care if they show up on the first day to class, right? We want to again, if we put one of our core values at our company is if we put students first, we think everything is going to work out in the end, whatever that means. So, if we do what's right by the students, we help them be successful, we'll be successful.
That makes sense. And then, so if a veteran is interested in going, can you use the veterans benefits for boot camps or for you specifically?
Not yet. That's something we're working on. It's another, you know, there's kind of the state regulation, which is one layer. There's another layer for kind of the, you know, the GI Bill and everything. It's a lot more complicated and difficult than it might seem. We've actually looked at it multiple times. We're not there yet. So.
Okay. So then if somebody's looking, since you're in a specific area, if somebody's looking at going to a boot camp, what are the things that you would suggest that they look for at a boot camp? Yeah. Or stay away from too?
Great question. I would say if you're looking at a boot camp, you got to do your homework on number one, what do you want to learn, right? Because depending on the technology you're going to learn, you may find that you're going to be in a lot of competition with other people for jobs, or you may be in a really good market. Some people know what language they want to learn before they ever show up or ask us questions, and so that can be helpful. If you don't know what you want to learn, that's fine too. I think then it's just all about doing research on the school itself, right? You want to make sure you understand who they are, where they come from, what their students are doing, you know, and ask a lot of questions, right? Be willing to say, let me know who are some employers that have hired some of your graduates. Tell me about those. Can I talk to previous students? That's something that students have asked us, and we have a kind of a running list of alumni that are willing to talk to other students. And we welcome that because we want them to be very sure about the decision they're making. It's a pretty big decision in their lives. And so we want to give them as much assurance as possible that it's a good move for them.
Okay. Is there any voluntary accreditation? Like, are there any special gold stars that they should be looking for?
So we've got kind of our own internal credentialing that we use. Yeah. And that's more really for our benefit to say, do you meet the minimum standards that we feel like you need to meet to be employable, or do you not? Right. And, but to be honest, that credential doesn't carry a lot of weight outside of DevMountain because, in this industry, one of the reasons that boot camps even exist is because employers are looking past the 4-year degree to say, okay, well, what can you actually do? If you can do what you say you can do, then I'm going to hire you. I don't care if you've got a degree or not. I mean, I never got a degree in computer science. I learned by teaching myself and by trolling the internet, and it was a super painful process. But ultimately, once I could prove to people that I had skills and I had competency, that's what mattered. So the credentialing is kind of not as important, especially to employers, as your ability to demonstrate your skill.
Okay. And then I guess one of the questions I'm just thinking about with this is, it seems like the boot camp concept should be transferable to 99% of the professions out there. Is it focused on coding simply because there's just a crap ton of money there? Like, why can't you go to a PR boot camp or advertising boot camp or something like that? Is there something that keeps people from doing that?
I think there are other opportunities like that out there. However, I think the coding industry is unique in that, number one, there's the stat that everybody likes to quote from the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, where basically what it's saying is the number of jobs that require, technical talent are growing at a faster rate than we are producing people to fill those jobs. So as long as that demand gap continues, then that is going to drive a lot of these employers to say, well, we can't be as choosy and require an Ivy League degree and, X amount of years of experience, right? Like, we've just got to get people in the door that can do this stuff. So that's one part of it, is that job demand and the availability, the supply and demand part of it fuels a lot of it. Another piece to the puzzle is traditional education's ability to adapt to the marketplace, right? So if a 4-year university can create the kind of programs and meet the employment needs, then great. They're going to be able to do that. And a lot of employers have longstanding relationships with universities that they go in and recruit and whatnot. Sure. But coding is, again, unique because universities can't keep up with all the changes. And so the curriculum is by definition kind of out of their reach in a lot of ways. So I think those two factors play a big role in being able to create something that's successful. So like, if you were to come to me and say, hey, I want to make a boot camp that teaches, I'm just going to pull something, teaches dental hygiene assistants or something like that. I would start asking you questions like, well, number one, what's the job market like for dental assistants? Because you know, if there's way too many people applying for the same jobs, then they're going to start putting artificial criteria in there to just to thin out the herd a bit, right? Yeah. And boot camps aren't going to survive as well in that type of environment unless they're just amazingly exceptional. And then number two, how quickly does the curriculum change for that kind of thing, right? Is it something that you can teach for 10 years and not change a single thing? And if so, then the boot camps maybe aren't the right vehicle for that. But yeah, I think what I like about this model of education is it kind of changes the playing field a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. We have been taught and cultured growing up to say, well, you got to go to a 4-year to university just to do anything, like just to be able to do anything. And I think that people are starting to realize that's not necessarily true. First of all, we've got this huge student debt crisis that's happening where people are incurring crazy amounts of debt and never being able to pay it back with the kinds of jobs they're getting. So that's one part of it. But then also, you know, there are just other ways to learn things, especially with the internet and this information age that we live in. Why can't you go online and take it, you know, an open course from MIT, learn some code or whatever, and kind of, you know, build your own educational process? I hope that we're kind of entering an era where those kinds of experiences are recognized and become more commonplace, and we get smarter about how we do education, because ultimately the cost structure of higher education is not sustainable. And at some point we're not going to be able to afford it anymore. And, you know, I'm not trying to be a doomsday or anything, but it's just getting so expensive. It's rising, cost of tuition is rising faster than inflation. And we've just got to figure out how to address it. And so, you know, boot camps in a small way are making a dent in that problem. And hopefully, if nothing else, we're going to contribute to kind of a newer model of education that will be more sustainable.
Okay. Well, I guess to finally round this out then. So you weren't planning to create DevMountain. So kind of tell us, like, what is your story? How do you get from wherever you were to CEO founder of DevMountain?
Yeah. So I guess really briefly, I went to school, had no idea what I wanted to do. About halfway, 2/3 of the way through my undergraduate, I decided I wanted to get into web development. This was post.com. You know, mm-hmm. bubble burst. And so it wasn't necessarily a popular time to get into web development, but there was still a ton of jobs out there and demand and not very many people teaching it. Like, I was trying to find classes at my university, and there was really only a couple that talked about web development specifically. A lot of them were willing to teach you Java and other stuff, but I wanted to learn web development. And so I kind of was forced into this position where I had to teach myself, and it was a pain. Like, this was before Stack Overflow, and I was out there literally trolling forums and trying to figure out the last post where the answer was given. And like, I mean, I had no mentor to kind of guide me to the next step. It was just a really painful, long process. So that was kind of the background that I came from, where I was self-taught. I experienced the challenges of learning on your own and then made a successful career out of being a software developer, but had a lot of interfacing with education to the extent that, you know, I kind of learned what was effective and what wasn't. So, you know, I ran a consulting company where we kind of specialized in building online learning products. Okay. And so, you know, got a lot of exposure to education there. And as a result, I ended up getting a master's degree just to kind of shore up my ability to, you know, create good things that were instructionally sound. Uh-huh. And just saw very firsthand, like, A, you know, how, you know, the science of learning and kind of how that plays in everything, and B, just kind of some of the inefficiencies of higher education. And so those two kind of things were independently brewing, right? Like, this passion for education and this technical side of me. And, you know, for 10 years or so, I spent working, you know, a combination of large companies and startups. And when the opportunity to teach part-time classes presented itself, it was just kind of a, hey, this would be a fun, fulfilling side thing to do. Yeah. It suddenly like clicked. It made so much sense to me that like this was something that would be really good for me to do, because I have the education background and I have the technical background, but I'd never really married them in a super meaningful way. And so I started teaching just part-time classes, and it went really well. Mm-hmm. And then it was like, wow, maybe this is something that I could actually do full-time, and just made a lot of sense. So I went from working for a startup, you know, building stuff every day, to teaching people and building our own stuff. And, yeah. It's been a great journey so far.
That's cool. Were you able to bootstrap it, or are you a startup yourself, or? Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think the business model itself, it kind of lends itself to bootstrapping, because, you know, there aren't many businesses where your customers give you all your revenue on day one, and then that's kind of your working capital for the rest of the time. So we bootstrapped it, which is both, really cool, but it was also at times really terrifying, because when you don't have a lot of VC money sitting in the bank, it's like you feel like you're rolling the dice every single day. Yeah. We would feel very fortunate to be able to come out and be successful, but it's been a crazy journey.
So I guess that's one question for a lot of entrepreneurs and startups is, I mean, especially when people are writing you $10,000 checks, there's got to be trust there. And so now you're DevMountain with three places and blah, 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 blah. But you know what? 4 years ago, you were you. Like, how did you create the trust that people were handing you 10 grand a pop?
That's such a good question. So I had just my personal networks. You know, I taught a little bit at university. I taught a little bit, just workshops and seminars and stuff. So I started there and just reached out and said, hey, how many of you would be interested in something like this? And it just kind of grew from there. And I think so some of my just personal relationship credibility kind of filtered into that. But there were some really funny times where we had students show up and be like, So you guys are like legitimate, right? I remember this one guy came and was like poking around asking all these questions and was like so concerned that we were just like fraudsters or something. And I think finally we basically told him, like, look, dude, if you don't want to do this, like, nobody's forcing you here. Like, please, if you don't feel good about this, then just don't do it. We don't want you to be so scared and freaked out that you can't even learn what you need to learn. To be honest, we had a lot of just – I remember the very first full-time class we had, there was this gal that, bless her heart, was like part super homesick and part just like struggling in the class. And there was multiple times where I sat down with her and she was just crying, saying like, I don't know if I can do this. Should I go home? Like, did I make the right decision? And I just had to look her in the eyes and say, like, stick with it. You're going to be fine. You're going to get there. And luckily now she's like a big advocate of ours, and she can go talk to students and tell them her story and say how important it was for her to stick with it. And so, you know, it takes time to build that, but if you do it right, and if you get some of those student experiences, I mean, you know, a good percentage of our students come from word of mouth referrals from previous students. So that tells me that we're doing something right.
Ah, cool. So then I guess my final question, because I just got to ask, since you're in Utah now. So we here on the East Coast hear that Silicon Valley and San Francisco is the promised land. There is no other place in the world to be for technology. And apparently you left. So just out of curiosity, like, is there a reason for leaving San Francisco, or was it just like a family thing?
No, I love San Francisco. I would go back there, you know, if the opportunity was right. Loved my time there. But like any place, there's pluses and minuses, pros and cons. The cost of living is one really difficult one to swallow. Yeah. And maybe some of you on the East Coast are a lot more okay with that. But just the price you've got to pay to live in a market like that is tough to swallow. And I've got a wife and kids, and so for me it was even more substantial, because I needed more space than just a one-bedroom closet or something like that. I mean, we weren't necessarily looking to leave San Francisco. It was more of, we actually joined a startup that was in San Francisco, and then they moved to Utah, and then we kind of just moved with them. So it just kind of happened that way. But being here, I also see there's a lot of good advantages. There's a lot of great benefits for not necessarily working in, you know, the Mecca of San Francisco. I mean, there are more companies nowadays that are open to kind of the, you know, remote workforce than ever before. You know, the internet flattens the world a lot when it comes to the things you can learn wherever you are. But you want to be in a place where you feel like you can grow. You feel like you're surrounded by people that can teach you and that you can learn from and gain experience from. And if you can find that where you live, then hey, good on you, man. That's awesome. For me, I gained a lot from moving to San Francisco. I loved my time there, but I also love it here. So I guess I'm just kind of an easygoing guy.
Wow, great. So are you in Provo then, or Salt Lake City?
Yeah, I'm based in a city just outside of Provo.
Yeah. Okay. Good deal. So that's about all I've got. So do you have any like final parting words for the viewers at home?
You know, I guess I would just say, in kind of the spirit of geek and tinkering and all that kind of stuff, like, I love what I do. And if you can find something in your life that you're passionate about and that does some kind of good for other people, then like, what a cool thing to be a part of. And I just feel really lucky to be a part of something that does those things. I think the, oops, sorry, I'm back. Just find something you're passionate about and stick with it. And that's kind of the dream in my mind.
Cool. Well, thank you for talking with us today. It was a good little conversation here.
Yeah, absolutely. No problem.
Yeah. Here, I'll stop the broadcast and then I'll talk to you for a couple seconds. So, So that was Cahlan Sharp, CEO and founder of DevMountain. If you're interested in them, take a look at devmountain.com. Just as I have to say it, FTC compliance. They are one of my sponsors, been one of my sponsors for a while, but you all know what that means. So with that, I'll see you folks at the next video or at the next Geek with Coffee.